So that's something also to keep in mind. Just because they're not the highest overall does not mean you can't use them in your scheme, okay? Jonathan Stewart, he's my big 5'10", 235-pound back, so he's going to be running in between the tackles a lot for me. I don't want to go do a lot of outside runs with him. I want to run in between the tackles, okay? Amongst the big bodies. All right, another position to pay attention to is fullback. Depending on what type of scheme you want, you might not need a good fullback. You might not. So, he's more so a receiving type of fullback, though, Mike Tolbert. And short yardage guy, he's not really a good blocking tight end. I mean, excuse me, fullback. Now we go to the wideouts: Kevin Benjamin, Terry Ginn, Jericho Cockburn, Corey Brown. Okay, you set these guys up not so much off of overall, but how are you going to use them in the slot? Some people like to put their route runner there. Sometimes me, I like to put someone who has high run blocking there. Why? Because if you're the type of guy that runs with a fast guy and you do a lot of inside zones out of trips. Okay, any type of shotgun type of formation, you want somebody either a tight end or a good run blocking wide receiver. The reason why you have it's more beneficial to have a good run blocking wide receiver is it's more dynamic for you. Unless you have a stud tight end who can put a body on someone and still catch the ball as well. But the reason why you want to have a good is as for diversity. If you have a good If you want to run the ball out of guns, it's good to have a good guy, or at least switch him there out of the slot. That's if you're going to run a scheme out of there, but you can always sub that guy in. Biggest thing is you want your route runner here in your slot position. That's where you want your route runner. Your guy who has good route running and decent catching traffic. Look at that. That's why I want him in the slot. That is why he is in the slot, because he has great route running, better than even Ted Ginn and even better than Kevin Benjamin, and catches traffic. Is where it's at, because he's going to be around a lot of bodies. All right, he's not the fastest, but that's fine though, because he has good route running, so he can get open. You know what I mean? That's respectable route running. He can get open. All right, that's the biggest thing you want out of your guy in the slot. All right, and then the end guys, you usually want somebody who's balanced, and then you want a deep threat. All right, the guy doesn't have to be a fast to be a deep threat though. He can be tall with good catching traffic and good catching, like Kevin Benjamin has. He has good catching. And good catching traffic and good spectacular catch. So either, even though he's much slower than Ted Ginn, he ideally would be, if you were scheming with somebody who has similar attributes, would be somebody that could be a deep ball guy. Why? Because he can go up and get it. He doesn't have to be the fastest if he can go up and get it. He might not get a lot of rack, but he can go up and get it. So these are things that you can think about when you're planning your wideouts. Okay, what type of offense you're running one. And then Ted Ginn, he's fast, but let's check his size, right? 5'11", 185, which is most defensive back sizes. But let's find his release here. Be depressed. 73. Not gonna do that hot. It's not the worst, but he's not gonna do the best either, beating it. Okay. All right. So. All right. That's the end of those. Those things, the top three are the ones to pay attention to, though. You want guys with good route running and good hands. Tight end, all right? Depending on what type of scheme you want to run, you may want a guy that's better here with running or passing, or a good combination. Greg Olsen is more so receiving tight end, but because he is a big body, he can at least chip those guys out there that you want to have. Let's check his run block, because I'm not quite sure what it is right now. All right, so look at that. Atrocious, 58, all right? All right, but look at the pass block. So he's great at pass blocking. So you can always think about, know your guys, know your troops. It's just not to drag on or belabor a point, but it's just to really make sure that you hammer home, know your guys. All right. Are they good pass blockers? Look, he's rated 76 overall, right? Micah Orr, Mr. Blindside himself. But if you look at strength, is great. But it's really only beneficial when you're making contact with people. But then the biggest thing you want out of lineman is someone with good awareness. All right, so decent awareness. But what you want is someone who has impact blocking. And let me go to it. Oh my gosh. All right, and then running pass block. Okay, so if you're going to be pass heavy, this is the guy you keep in. 87 pass blocking. Pretty good. Good strength. Good awareness. Just this guy, but look at the run block. He's a freaking lineman who's 315 pounds, 6'4", and he only has 10 points higher on the run block than Greg Olsen, who's a receiving tight end. Okay. All right. And actually, I believe Jericho Crouchy has like a 62, who's a wideout run block. So it's much better than Michael Orr's is. All right. And his in block butt is pretty low. All right. Which is something you want out of someone when it comes to holding their blocks. Now you go down to Nate Chandler. He's a much lower overall guy, but look at his core attributes here. Run block, 83. Pass block, 75. He's more balanced. In block, but 80. So he's a much more balanced type of wide receiver. I mean, excuse me. lineman, left tackle, okay? So even though he's rated, to his overall, much lower, okay, 76 to 70, I would start him over him. I would. So, that's essentially the same type of concept. Know what you want to do and put the right type of people in the position to do the game. All right, so block shedding. All right, you want someone with good finesse moves and block shedding to get out that block. Block shedding is more so for the run game, but to be honest, I really over the years seen that if someone has higher awareness, it doesn't matter if their block shed is horrible or middle of the road. For some reason, I feel like awareness impacts so much in this game. That's why it has a big contributor on overall. All right. And then you have to think about it. Okay. I have two right ends and left ends, very close in the overall, but what do I want to do with them? You know what I mean? What do I want to do with those guys? And this could be starting off with the depth chart, or you can just have these guys sub in, but know your guys' attributes. Because me, if I had someone who was scrambling around a lot, I would put Mario Addison. If someone's scrambling around a lot with the quarterback, I would put Mario Addison in. Why? Because he is 5 points faster in speed than Jared Allen is, okay? That's the biggest reason why. So if I need to, I can have him play into a flat if I need to. If someone's abusing the flat quite a bit, right? I can have him play in the flat. He probably won't catch it. Let's look at his catching. But he can at least disrupt it. All right, so it's 50. Better than Jared Allen is. So there might be a chance there he could catch it. But the biggest thing is about that is that he has the body to go down there against the lineman. Because the biggest thing you want in your lineman, they're just to freaking busy up the offensive line. That way your linebackers can come through in the blitz or either make the run stop. Your lineman, if your defensive lineman, if that's why they always have less tackles than linebackers do. Why? Because they're there to clog up the holes. They're there to disrupt the running game, the passing game, so your linebackers can come in, or your safeties that are blitzing, your corners, they can come in and make the play on the ball. That's their job to do. And if you get somebody to make a sack or a safety, a sack or a tackle for loss, then that's bonus points, but that's not the main goal out there. You want somebody who can disrupt. They can get after the quarterback, don't get me wrong, but... And the biggest thing is a defensive line and defense can be successful with a team that never sacks the quarterback, but they're constantly in his face, you know what I mean? Or they're constantly getting tackles for loss, all right, and disrupting running lanes. So this is what you need to remember about your defensive line, all right? Depending on what type of scheme you're doing, me, with the Panthers, they have two good defensive tackles. Why? Because with the Panthers, they're running 4-3, all right? 4-3 is four defensive. Four defensive linemen, and usually three linebackers, traditionally, okay? All right? That's typically what you have. And then the other four are two corners and two safeties. That's a base 4-3, all right? Usually want your number one guy, depending on his abilities, he's usually going to be the top guy that's in, all right? With the Panthers, too, they have a different type of lineup when they have another spot you can sub in a defensive tackle because they have the 5-2 with five defensive linemen, which means a third defensive tackle comes in. So that's why they have this guy here too. So that's a good scheme to run to stop the run. That's the biggest thing you want on your linemen, though. They are disruptors, and if they get tackle for losses and sacks, that's awesome, but you want them to disrupt the play. All right, your outside linebackers, the attributes you want out of those guys is, again, depends on the scheme you're running one. Do you want to run a 3-4 base type of offense where you have mostly your outside linebackers are your pass rushing type of linebackers, while your two middle ones are coverage because you have four linebackers and three linemen. And that lineman, that defensive tackle, he usually is going to need to be a big body to block up those running lanes because he's going to have to force a lot of double teams because you're going to be at a disadvantage on the line. So that's something to remember. You can't run a 4-3 defense with outside linebackers that have poor block shedding, they're undersized, or they don't have attributes that are good at getting after the quarterback or stopping them. Okay, you want somebody typically 4-3 outside linebackers. They're good run stoppers, but a lot of times they're even better in coverage. If you notice with Carolina, they're outside linebackers, and well, all three of the linebackers actually are great in coverage. But that also adds another dynamic. If you have linebackers with great zone, you can get away with running a 4-3, depending on how good their zone is and how you set them up. But we'll go over that more later in another episode. Depending on how you set them up, you can get away with running a 4-3 against, like, you know, a 3 wide receiver set, you know. So, but more to come on that. So, yeah, this is just basically going over setups. I know I touched on defense a little bit, but we're going to go back to the O. All right, so we're going to run some plays here. We're going to pick a play and say what I am looking for. We're going to go with single back tight slots. We're going to sub a tight end, though, into that extra slot. Why? Because that gives the opportunity to run the ball. Should we choose, we'll pick a random play. All right, so this is going to give us the opportunity to run the ball because Ed Dixon has decent run blocking. It's like in his 60s, low 60s. Nearly up to Micah Orr. All right, so one thing I forgot to do is sub out Micah Orr because I don't want him in. But we'll go back and do that. So we're going to look. Will this running play work for me? All right. So the best thing you got to look at is how many people are in the line of scrimmage. Because those are going to be the first guys, like I was saying before, to clog up and disrupt your play. So the least amount of people are on the line, the better, to be honest. Especially if you're running out the gut. It depends on the position, but less people on the line, the better. Okay. So now we see. All right. We got a tight end in the slots. So what I'm going to do is, because I don't like this running play, I don't think it will be successful. I do think this play, however, will be successful because that linebacker just dropped down into the box more, right? Which shows me that he's trying to come in through that gap. So now we're going to look and see if it's a cover two. How you'll know if it's a cover two is if the two safeties go out to play the deep thirds, okay? The deep quarters, excuse me. Those, okay? Let's see. If so, Benjamin to be open. If not, and they stay home, depending on if they're playing man or zone, Olsen will be open or Stewart will be open. There's Jay Stu. Don't be afraid to be hot route heavy. What I mean by that is, I nearly hot route at least one to two routes every formation I come out in. Why? Just to give people different looks, all right? Especially for those who want to use it a middle linebacker, all right? So, one safety at top, we're going to send two people at him and see what works. We're going to send him on an out, a shallow out, and then we're going to send Ginn down on a drag, okay? So we're going to street two, we're going to send one drag in case the blitz comes, and then we're going to send him on a quick out. See what happens. All right. It looks like a cover one, though. And there's Ginn. Wide open. Give yourself, on just about any play you can give yourself one, give your a bailout, you know, so aka check down. Give you something they can check down in case the blitz come or if things are covered, all right, or if a play breaks down. You want something where, you know, and drags are great for that. On the offensive side, drives are great for that. They're usually always going to get open, all right? And you usually want to run your fast guy or your good route runner on the drives, okay? You want somebody that can bail you out in case the play goes unexpectedly, okay? So now, we're actually going to run this, the dive straight up, all right? I like what it was. Players are located on the outside, all right? So we actually have the benefit to get this. And look at that, boom. All right. Support the coverage again. Give him something to bait with, something to mess with. See if he bites. Give us something and bail out. Send him that way. Send Jonathan Stewart to swing left. So we had Olsen open and we had Jonathan Stewart open on that play. Okay. Let's go back and check it out. See? He checked him. So he did a quick little bump to try to knock him off his route, but so he was open. And he was open. Okay. Just because some guy comes in contact with your guy does not mean he's gonna run with him. See, he was just playing his own. So I could have popped him right there if I wanted to. I had Benjamin underneath. And then, of course, you saw me go to Jonathan Stewart for the safety yards. You don't want to run the ball if someone has eight people in the box. It just doesn't make any sense. The box is essentially 5 yards on the defensive side of the ball. Okay? All right, 5 yards behind the line of scrimmage on the defense side. Go back 5 yards and see how many people are have their bodies in there or close to that line. It's going to give you an idea of what type of coverage you can use, okay? I'm going to hit him with this now. See if I can get a one-on-one against Earl Thomas. If not, I'm looking for Ginn. Ah, see? Made a bad read that time. I hit him too late. We're going to run the ball again. Why? We got one linebacker in the middle. Defensive line is spread out. All right, so let's go with some random play running so we can see how we fare. Let's respot the ball first. Give ourselves a little more opportunity for a diverse play calling here. Don't be afraid to, what's that? Move people around as well. Audibles, hot riding, moving personnel around will all benefit you. Bring him in. See, now look at the mismatch. It was a corner on me. Now there's a linebacker on me. I'm going to see him on the street. Him as well. If Cam Newton could throw an accurate ball, that would have been a great out route. Alright. So now we're going to see Ed Dixon shallow. So we got two safe ones. And we're going to look, of course, deep first. See where the safety goes. Alright, he goes there. Boom, got Dixon. All right, I'm looking for Kotry. If Kotry isn't there, Olsen should be. Couldn't hold on to it. I like this setup. We're seeing Benjamin on the deep too, as well. If it ain't there, we'll go for Dixon. Dixon isn't there, we're looking for Jace too. Get off the ball, guy. But the concept was there. He was open. I couldn't get it to him though. So, I mean, that's the biggest thing about it. Knowing what you want to do and actually being able to do it are two very different things. Okay, so that's something that you always have to keep in mind too. You can have all the planning in the world, but without execution, it's not going to really amount to much, okay? See what happens when you run it? Let's see if he's playing man. We'll find out real soon, based off with this. Especially since he's pressing Benjamin. A lot of people like to leave talented corners alone. But in this game, Leaving a corner one-on-one against a talented wide receiver is usually going to end poorly for the talented cornerback because it's just the way the game is with aggro catching and stuff like that. It's usually a 7 times out of 10 the wideout will come down with the ball. You see a guy, I can't simulate it, but if you see a guy heavy usering, right, let's say like a lot of people like use the middle linebacker, this is a perfect route for that. All right, a guy who's heavy usering the middle linebacker, because what you do is you send him, boom, you give him busy, make him make a decision. Same thing, make him make a decision. Like you will choose someone. A lot of people like to take the middle linebacker and have him help cheat out. Alright, you'll pick someone then. You want to play with him? You'll pick someone. Simple as that. Make them choose if you catch someone heavy user in the middle linebacker. Make them choose. Flood them. And come on, Troy Turner. So, yeah, man. Hope you guys enjoyed the tutorial. Give me any tips on how I could better present these. I'm new to this whole speaking and trying to articulate myself while I'm playing a game at the same time. I could do it if I weren't playing a game in a more concise way. But yeah, let me know if anybody didn't benefit from this, and definitely we'll be having a question and answer here on week 4 from the community. So prepare your questions so that way I can address those in that stream. Ideally, I wanted to do it last because it gives you opportunity to have all the tutorials essentially and all of the concepts that I'm trying to put out there, and it will help you formulate your questions better should you have any for week 4 once I lay it all out, because I may answer some questions later on in the coming weeks. But yeah, guys, I wish some of you guys would have been able to make the stream, but hey, it's all good. Yeah, trying to do my part for Madden PFL. You guys are awesome, and have a great day. Till next time. Oh, yeah, next time will be defensive concepts or approaches, I should say, as well as the same type of concept when it comes to knowing your personnel, okay? And then my favorite would be week 3 with the usering and how to user, all right, and some usering counters, okay? All right, that's it, guys. Take care. Hope you all have a great day.